My topic is pulmonary hypertension, which is a life-threatening condition affecting 1% of the population. Over the next 15 minutes, I will be talking about the definition, classification, algorithmic approach, treatment, and finally screening. As per the Sixth World Symposium, pulmonary hypertension is defined as mean pulmonary artery pressure more than 20 millimeter mercury at rest by right heart catheterization. The exercise part of the definition has been removed in 2008. The cutoff has been lowered from 25 to 20, mainly because of two reasons. In large populations, the normal mean pulmonary artery pressure has been found to be 14 with a standard deviation of 3. And mean pulmonary artery pressure varying from 21 to 24 is an independent predictor of mortality as seen in multiple studies. Pulmonary hypertension is broadly classified into five groups based on the site and underlying pathophysiology. Group 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension is characterized by an obstructive proliferative pathology at the level of the pulmonary arterial branch. Group 2 is due to left heart disease affecting the left atrium. Group 3 due to lung disease or hypoxia affects the capillary bed. And group 4 is due to pulmonary artery obstruction. Group 5 is unclear or multifactorial. At the Sixth World Symposium, it was recommended that in addition to the mean pulmonary artery pressure at right heart catheterization, two other measurements are used in the definition, that is the pulmonary capillary bed pressure and pulmonary vascular resistance. Accordingly, pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension consisting of group 1, 3, and 4 is defined as a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure less than or equal to 15 and a pulmonary vascular resistance greater than or equal to 3 Wood units. Post-capillary pulmonary hypertension, that is group 2, is defined as a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure more than 15 and a pulmonary vascular resistance less than 3 Wood units. Of the groups, the most common is group 2, followed by group 3, group 4, and group 1 is the least common. There has been changes in the subgroups, and group 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension now consists of 7 subgroups, namely idiopathic, heritable, drugs and toxin induced, associated PH consisting of connective tissue disease, HIV, schistosomiasis, congenital heart disease, and portal hypertension. 1.5 is PH long-term responders to calcium channel blockers. PH with overt features of venous capillary is 1.6, and it is now classified under pulmonary arterial hypertension due to the common obstructive proliferative pathology. 1.7 is persistent pulmonary hypertension of the newborn. Now, though connective tissue disease is classified under group 1, pulmonary hypertension in the setting of connective tissue disease can also be due to other groups. For example, SLE with cardiomyopathy could cause group 2 pulmonary hypertension. Interstitial lung disease in the setting of scleroderma could cause group 3 disease. And pulmonary thromboembolism in SLE could cause group 4. Group 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension is mainly contributed by idiopathic in 46% cases and associated PH in 50% cases as per the REVEAL registry. Now, talking specifically about connective tissue disease, PAH, this constitutes 25% of all PH and it's the second leading cause of PAH. And as compared to idiopathic PH, which is represented by the black line in the survival curve, connective tissue disease PH, the green line, has worse survival. And the diseases constituting connective tissue diseases PH are scleroderma in the majority, followed by SLE, MCTD, RA. Sjogren's and myositis are rarer cause. Now, of scleroderma, 2/3 are of the limited subtype, and this could cause the diagnosis to be missed in some patients. So how to improve the pickup of connective tissue disease? Every time pulmonary hypertension is diagnosed, consider the possibility of underlying connective tissue disease. Look for clues, Raynaud's, sclerodactyly, telangiectasia, etc. Do ANA by immunofluorescence and never ELISA. The Sixth World Symposium recommends this panel of antibodies when there is high suspicion of CTD, PAH, anticentromere, SCL70, RNA polymerase 3, U1RNP, dsDNA, Rho, and Lam. And if there is suspicion of group 4, pulmonary, that is chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, antiphospholipid antibodies needs to be looked for. Next, this is the algorithm for evaluation and treatment of pulmonary hypertension, which starts with having a high suspicion. Remember, even when history, examination, chest X-ray, and ECG are normal, patient could still have pulmonary hypertension. So the first non-invasive modality is to do an echo. And if echo shows high probability of pulmonary hypertension, patient needs to be evaluated for the underlying group of pulmonary hypertension. Start with the most common, that is group 2, and proceed towards the least common. So first, look for presence of significant left heart disease on the echo, which indicates group 2 pulmonary hypertension. If left heart disease is not present, then look for significant lung disease or hypoxia by doing a combination of tests such as PFT, CT, ABG, and sleep studies. And this could indicate the diagnosis of group 3 pulmonary hypertension. Remember, in group 2 and group 3, pH-specific therapy is generally not indicated. Treat the underlying disease. If group 2 and group 3 are negative, proceed to do a VQ scan. If it is positive, do angiography along with a coagulopathy screen. This could lead to the diagnosis of group 4 pulmonary hypertension, and here patient needs to be on lifelong anticoagulation. Pulmonary endarterectomy or balloon pulmonary angioplasty is the treatment of choice. Where intervention is not possible, treatment with riociguat is indicated. Now, if all the common three groups are excluded, proceed to do a right heart cath, and if the hemodynamic parameters mentioned previously are fulfilled, then group 1 or pulmonary arterial hypertension is diagnosed. Remember, we need not be very rigid with this flowchart, and suppose we have a patient with high risk of pulmonary arterial hypertension, such as hereditary PH or limited scleroderma, they can be directly referred for right heart cath without following the intervening steps. Now, group 1 is the pulmonary arterial hypertension where pH-specific therapy is indicated. So now let us talk about the drugs. These act mainly on three pathways, and the endothelin pathway is overexpressed in pulmonary arterial hypertension, and this leads to vasoconstriction and proliferation. This pathway can be blocked by endothelin receptor antagonist. Example for selective endothelin receptor antagonist is ambrisentan, and dual endothelin receptor antagonist are bosentan and macitentan. Drugs acting on the nitric oxide pathway are the soluble guanylate cyclase stimulator, that is the riociguat, or PDE5 inhibitors, sildenafil and tadalafil. The drugs acting on the prostacyclin pathway are prostacyclin analogs, ipoprostenol, tripoprostenol, iloprost, or the oral drug selexipag. It is very important to remember that drugs in the same pathway cannot be combined. For example, riociguat cannot be combined with phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. Now, is there any role for calcium channel blocker therapy? Yes, this is indicated in patients with idiopathic, hereditary, and drug-induced PH only if vasoreactivity is demonstrated on right heart catheterization. So there is a paradigm shift to combination therapy because it has been found that whether newly diagnosed or treated pulmonary arterial hypertension, combination therapy has been found to have superior outcome in terms of symptoms, exercise capacity, and survival. So those with low to moderate risk are started upfront on ERA and PDE5 inhibitors, and in case of inadequate response, selexipag is added. Those at high risk should be commenced on IV prostacyclin analog along with ERA and PDE5 inhibitors and referred for lung transplantation. Because the treatment is decided based on the risk factors, we should know the factors associated with high risk. These are male gender, connective tissue disease, function class 3 or 4, decreased 6-minute walk distance, decreased systolic BP, increased pulse rate, raised BNP, right ventricular failure, pericardial effusion, and elevated pulmonary vascular resistance. Now, two comments about supportive therapy. Anticoagulation is generally not recommended in associated PH, including CTD PH. And in CTD PH, immunosuppression possibly has a role in non-scleroderma diseases. Now, next slides are about screening. Screening for asymptomatic patients is recommended in scleroderma and scleroderma spectrum diseases. In other connective tissue diseases, evaluation for pulmonary hypertension is recommended only if the patients are symptomatic. Why to screen asymptomatic scleroderma? Because 12% of scleroderma develop PH, 3-year survival is 50%, PH accounts for 30% mortality in scleroderma, and more than 2/3 are in NYHA functional class 3 or 4 at the time of diagnosis of PH in scleroderma. And as can be seen in the survival curve, NYHA functional class 3 and 4 are associated with worse survival. And it is hoped that by screening, patients can be detected in NYHA functional class 1 and 2 and can be treated well, leading to better outcome. Now, let us talk about the role of transthoracic echo in pulmonary hypertension. Remember, this is for screening and not for diagnosis. Advantages of echo are that this helps us to assess the RV and LV function. However, disadvantages are that this is subjective and patient-related factors such as obesity and chest deformity could interfere with the assessment. Now remember, echo does not give the mean pulmonary artery pressure. The value in echo that indicates pulmonary hypertension is the systolic pulmonary artery pressure, otherwise called the RV systolic pressure. This is derived from tricuspid velocity and right atrial pressure. The current guidelines do not recommend using this value. Why? Because in 50% of cases, the RVSP obtained from echo differs from the right heart cath values by more than 10 millimeter mercury. So this could lead to underestimation or overestimation of pulmonary hypertension. Let me give an example of overestimation. 73 consecutive scleroderma patients with suspected PH underwent right heart catheterization. Suspicion of pulmonary arterial hypertension was based on RVSP value more than 40 and DLCO and FVC. So, when the right heart cath was done, the diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension was proven in 39 patients only, just above 50%. Specifically, group 1 PH was found only in 27. If we were to make a diagnosis based on echo, 73 patients would have to be commenced on ER and PDE5 inhibitor, whereas it would be truly indicated only in 27. So it is very clear that RVSP is not to be used. But what are the guidelines to be used? So the guidelines to be used are the 2015 European Society of Cardiology and Respiratory Society guidelines, which gives us the probability of pulmonary hypertension based on three parameters. First and foremost is the tricuspid velocity. Second, the echo signs of pulmonary hypertension. And third, symptoms. So a patient who has tricuspid velocity more than 3.4 has high probability of pulmonary hypertension and must be referred for right heart cath irrespective of other signs or symptoms. Tricuspid velocity 2.9 to 3.4 is associated with an intermediate probability and must be referred in case of presence of echo signs or symptoms. Tricuspid velocity less than 2.8 has low probability and must be referred if both echo signs and symptoms are present. So what are the symptoms? These are symptoms of dyspnea, syncope, or peripheral edema, and the echo signs pertain to measurements related to inferior vena cava or right atrial area, second pulmonary artery, third right ventricle. So if at least two of the three are fulfilled, then we can say that the patient fulfills the echo signs. Now, the problem with this guidelines is that tricuspid velocity cannot be obtained in 20 to 39% of pulmonary hypertension. And so now it is easy to understand how echo underestimates pulmonary hypertension. Moving on, let me talk about the DETECT algorithm. DETECT algorithm is a two-step decision tree that was applied in patients with scleroderma of more than 3 years duration and DLCO less than 60%. So patients with scleroderma were screened in two steps. In the first step, six non-echo variables, namely FVC-DLCO ratio, telangiectasia, right axis deviation on ECG, anticentromere antibodies, NT-proBNP, and serum urate were used to calculate a risk score. If the risk score was more than 300, patient was referred for echo. The derived score from step one was added to the score of two echo variables, that is the right atrial area and TR velocity. And if the score obtained was more than 35, patient was referred for right heart catheterization. In this study, right heart catheterization echo was done in all the 446 patients and PH was diagnosed in 87. So they found that as compared to DETECT algorithm, which missed only 4% of PH diagnosis, routine echo missed diagnosis in 29%. So this is very sensitive, and patients were diagnosed in early NYHA functional class in 64% of cases. However, DETECT algorithm has low specificity, which means that more patients were referred for right heart cath, and that means this is expensive. So finally, let me conclude by telling the recommendations put out by the Six World Symposium. So all scleroderma spectrum patients should be subjected to annual screening. The first step is to do DLCO. If DLCO is greater than 80%, risk for pulmonary hypertension is low, and screening by a routine echo would be enough. However, if DLCO is less than 80%, risk of pulmonary hypertension is high, and patients must be screened either by the 2015 European guidelines to the DETECT algorithm. And the third methodology for screening is using a combination of FVC-DLCO ratio more than 1.6 and two-fold rise in NT-proBNP. If the patient tests positive for any of these screening methodologies, patient must be referred for right heart catheterization, which is the ultimate word in diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension. I would like to stop here and thank you.